Hi, so my name is Eugen Schindler, and I'm also presenting on behalf of Christina Moneva. She's also here. That's the lady in the in the back that's waving. Okay, so the first time I saw MPS was in 2009. Marcus was in the region of Eindhoven giving a nice speech on model-based, model-driven software development. And I remember quite well what he said back then. He showed actually a demo where there was something like C-sharp mixed with Java, mixed with something like SQL. And he said, I have no clue what to do with it, but it's really cool. And then, I think 2 years later or something, I saw on a CodeGen conference, first kind of stages of Embedder. And then I really thought, well, this is cool. I need to start doing this as well. So, let me tell you first a little bit about OTC. It's actually pronounced OTC. Most people say OCE, but it's actually OTC. And the name comes from actually from two German words, ohne Komponente. And ohne Komponente refers to, it's a 120-year-old company, even more, I think 135 or something. And the company is in the roots a chemical company. They started with coloring agents for butter and margarine. Back in the past, or even nowadays, it seems that when you have butter from cows that are in the winter and eat some inside food, versus butter when it's, for example, a day, nice sun, good grass, and so on, there's a big difference. The one looks a lot more yellow, and the other one looks kind of pale. And I think with margarine is it kind of looks bluish. No one wants to eat that. So there were the two van de Grinten brothers, and they found a way to basically distill a natural coloring thing without any special added stuff, ohne Komponente, that can be used for using as a coloring agent for the margarine. OTC has reinvented itself a number of times. So they went basically from butter and margarine coloring, I don't know the exact years, but at some point to the so-called blueprint printing process. Yeah, so that those are the really old things that you can see in the museum when they really had to, when you had like blue paper with white kind of lines or whatever to copy things. And then after that, somewhere around, I think, the 70s, 80s, they started to go to toner printers, and then to toner digital, and nowadays actually moved on to inkjet digital. And at OTC, we have a lot of ideas, and we also have a lot of reality to deal with those ideas. So for that, we like tool support for our ideas. And I also have to say that currently, for some of the most intensively MPS-supported ideas, we are using much from MPS and almost everything from Embedder platform and Embedder, except for grammar cells, which I promise we will fix very soon. Actually, one of the projects in progress really needs this, so we're going to change that very soon. So let me tell you a little bit about OTC products. Here are some of the most, the biggest examples of OTC products. So we have, for example, things that are, well, it's kind of this big, and you can put big sheets in it, and they keep rolling. And one of the fastest one from these, so it says 500 posters per day, but just to give you an idea, one of the fastest ones runs with 2 meters per second. Can you imagine flying 2 meters every second out of a printer like this? That's how high productive those systems are. This one is also very interesting. It works actually not on a normal inkjet, but it works on an inkjet gelling, which means you can increase productivity and print quality a lot. It's usually printed not on paper. It's actually printed, for example, on big sticker things or on big kind of, when you have to put some commercial in a bus. Very durable stuff and UV hardened, something that can actually survive outside in the sun quite well, and in the rain and everything. And because it's gelling, you can print one layer on top of the other while it's still drying. That means you can actually control, you can really on a still drying layer print, which means you can with the same kind of print quality maintain a very high productivity. And then we have, for example, something like the Variprint i300. That's a full color inkjet printer, 300 pages per minute. That translates to about 25,000 brochures per day. And I like to keep this one, to tell about this one. These are table printers. You can print all kinds of things, so not only paper, but for example, you can put a door on it. Some of them are like this big, let's say from the TV till here. That would be the print carriage part, this one. And you can print a door on it, or you can, for example, say, well, I have a load robot with 100,000 pens that I want to print the JetBrains logo on, for example. You load it on, and then you start printing. And the interesting thing about this, it's not a flat surface. If you have pens from the side, they look a bit like this. So you have to take into account the fact that those things are bending. And that has an influence on how your droplets have to fall, actually. We have a very nice setup in OSE for kind of high school students to show how hard that can be to accurately position these things. And basically, we have a three-story high building. I don't know exactly how much, maybe 15 meters high or something. And then there is a cross somewhere about maybe this big, made with duct tape or something. And then you have to drop, it's actually a little project for them to do with a little robot to move around, you have to drop a tennis ball exactly on that thing. And I can tell you it's not easy. With all the air resistance and all the stuff that goes on, it's not easy. And then we have the bigger things that print even more, even faster. Those are the so-called web printing presses. With very, very high volumes, as you can see. You have to think about bigger newspapers or very big kind of amounts of things that you have to print, booklets. Yes? I'm sorry? Okay, the question is, so when you have the pens lying like this, as from the example, do you have to make a spherical transformation for this or not? I can generically answer that for this kind of table printers, not in all cases, but there where it really matters, you have to take into account how the print medium actually is formed. Much of it is a combination of software and hardware. Yeah. Okay, so these big machines, they're actually developed and produced about 30 minutes from here, namely in Poin, the German side of OSE. And just to give you an idea, some of these machines, it's not on here, but there is one that does cardboard printing. And if you want to really seriously test this stuff, you need to print cardboard, unless you do it virtually, of course, but you need to print cardboard. And one day testing volume is a few, I don't know, two or three containers. I think even five or something. I remember a guy from Poing telling me. Stacked on top of each other. Just those load containers, you know, the ones that you have in Rotterdam or whatever. Just to give you an idea of the volumes. So, yeah, printing is not only about paper. I told you already pens and these kind of things. But I think this is also two nice examples. So, for example, if you think about bathroom tiles, would you think about printing? Usually nowadays, when you go to the IKEA and you buy, okay, tiles, maybe not IKEA, but a table, it's printed. If you go and if you have, for example, a nice couch with some beautiful flower pattern on top of it or something, that's called textile printing. And personally, what I really like as an example of printing, we're actually kind of in the business of, yeah, I don't know if I'm allowed to say it like that, but it really sounds cool, painting forgery. There was a nice project with the University of Amsterdam and with the Microsoft that made special 3D scanners that scan what you can see here. Actually, this is part of the painting, and this is the actual relief of how it looks like under certain lighting conditions, special museum conditions. And then an OSE printer prints this. And those things are really expensive. You can buy them. But once you put it on your wall, you can touch it. We have the Canon Experience Center. People come by and they really make pictures like, oh, I'm touching a real Vermeer or a Van Gogh or something. I really like to make these kind of pictures. So this we call 2.5D printing. We call it 2.5D and not 3D because it doesn't need any special support. So you basically have something like a plane and you make it smaller and smaller, and then you don't have a problem with gravity. That's why not exactly 3D, but there are a lot of applications for this. For example, we also are able to print very nice iPhone cases or phone cases in general with this. Actually, if you ever come to the Experience Center, you can get small examples of this really printed on the Eiger project printers. Not that I'm aware of. Sorry, the question was, do you print money as well? Okay, so let's zoom a little bit into a print system. Software-wise, I mainly look at the software now, we are dealing with something called the controller and the engine. The controller, yeah, kind of this part, although it's also in the inside the engine. I think it's somewhere here, inside some electronics thing. And the engine, the print engine, is actually the thing that's responsible for making the paper dirty or the whatever the medium that you're printing. And the controller is usually responsible for all kind of things like making it possible for an operator to do printing. Yeah, so we're not talking about some table printer and that you put there and then you have a printer driver. We're actually talking about a production printer, that's how we call them. And yeah, UI is an obvious one, huh? Job management. You can imagine that if you have a usual thing that you want to print, that's kind of like, let's say, a PDF with a number of pages. And then I have some print provider that says, so that's one of our clients, that says, well, I have here some paper, maybe the cheapest possible toilet paper or very expensive stuff that I want to use for a Vogue. And it's A3 format. Now, here you have the PDF. From there, go and actually print it as efficiently as possible, use as little as possible paper, and so on. So then you have to know exactly what you're doing afterwards, stapling, cutting, all the things that you that in the end comes in the booklet. You have to know before, when you are printing the actual image, what will happen to that. And that's how you can match a simple PDF to an actual job of, let's say, 25,000 booklets that you have to print in a day. Of course, workflows, planning, these kind of things. Yeah, so there is this, for example, these printers are used for specifically this one, i300, for example, in factories to print books on demand. And there is this nice thing that I've heard from a colleague. I don't know if it's anecdotal or not, but it's a really cool story. Is how productive these printers are is they have a number of printers, like two or three. And there's a print operator who sits from somewhere far away where he can see the traffic lights of the printers. So red means I need attention. Maybe a medium is finished or the ink is finished. And orange means I will soon need attention. Something is finishing. And green means everything is perfect. So this guy is sitting there with a bike. And if he knows that something needs to be refilled, he really needs to run with the bike, with whatever he has, his ink or his medium, go over there, refill it, and bike back again, and then a few seconds later he has to go to the next printer. As for the engine, and again I'm talking for now from a software perspective, so usually the embedded software people, that's embedded software departments, it's where I work, Christina works in the controller department, we are basically responsible for a piece of equipment, hardware, with a lot of sensors and actuators and all kinds of things that can be moved. And I'm not entirely fair, together with the mechatronics people, we are responsible to bring behavior to this, to make this thing alive. And as a consequence of this, we are actually responsible for a number of what we call total aspects. I think in the outside world on system architecting, you could call this quality attributes of a system. And those are basically productivity, obvious one, hey, if you're removing sheets, then it's maybe 200 sheets per minute or 300 sheets per minute. Data trends analysis means we need to enable people, we call them functional designers, who are actually can be mapped to the role of a system engineer in the outside world, to look at, let's say, their designs from the field and from so-called from prototypes, which we call usually lab models. Just imagine I'm a printhead designer and I want to have a printhead design that will as gracefully as possible degrade. Printheads are one of the most expensive parts of a printer. Then it's very good if I have a way to actually collect the information, logging, and an infrastructure where I can go and make trend analysis and these kind of things. Very recently, we got the systems variability aspect, which means that it's not only on software level, but you have to consider what on the system level, when you work with a product line of printers, where you get all kinds of impacts and where you touch. And also quite obvious error handling. You move stuff through the machine. Maybe there is somewhere a dog ear in a paper, and that dog ear is maybe too high for the print heads. If I'm going to hit the print heads, there is a risk. Oh, we have this nice mechanism that can just spit it out before you go under the print head. Just one example of error handling. Now, to give you a few examples of the kind of variability you can have in these printers. So you can, for example, have a very basic printer setup with just a simple exit station. You can have the same printer setup with a lot of finishing equipment behind it. Stapling, stitching, cutting, all these kind of things, making booklets. Or you can have the same kind of equipment or very similar kind of finishing equipment with different engines inside. For example, here is a Canon engine. Or here we have the i300 engine, and here we have, I think, the VP6000. But you can also, in terms of variability, go inside an engine, and then you would have, for example, the paper input station, or you would have the paper transport thing. And you can already see that here I'm not entirely fair, because the paper transport doesn't only go here, but it also goes here. So this is a kind of module cross-cutting aspect. You have the printing module, the heart of the printer, basically, with the entire printing process, how the droplets have to fall, and so on. And this little thing here with the drum, or little, it's actually quite big. A person can crawl inside of it. I remember they once made a bet, can someone crawl inside or not? And he came out with a completely ripped shirt, because this stuff inside here has a lot of kind of like ridges to steer a lot of heaters. So what this does is, after the printing, it does a fixation. Because in production printer, one of the things that's really important is also print robustness. Once I have a print finished, it cannot be curled, it cannot be somehow deformed, but also it cannot be, if I go outside and a droplet falls on it, then suddenly the ink starts going wrong. Or imagine if I have a stack of paper that I'm going to stack, and it's all maybe not properly yet fixated or properly dried. You can imagine what happens to that stack. Everything sticks. And then as a last one, there's finishing equipment. It could be a very simple stacker. I've seen recently a setup where they stack a lot of paper, like from the bottom till here, and then some load robot comes and gets this in the factory. But it can also be all kinds of equipment that up to where you say, I want a print job and I want to send it to 5,000 people directly ready in envelopes, where at the end of the line, basically a postal truck is waiting to bring around everything. So this kind of finishing equipment you can think about. Now, this is not meant to read all of it, but it's just to give you an expression, impression of the kind of technologies that we are using at USE. So these are the things at the controller side. So you can see a lot of programming languages, different mixed languages. Partially, that's because of, how do you call that? Legacy stuff. But partially, it's also really inherently, because we need to offer web UIs to people, and we need to use different kinds of technologies to be able to do what we do with our printers. And for the engine side, we're actually using very much the so-called ROOM, the real-time object-oriented modeling kind of technology, which means that instead of writing a lot of flat C or C++ code, you specify most of the behavior for the printer, the high-level control behavior, except for the, let's say, the mechatronic stuff. You specify it in state machines and in a number of component diagrams. And then you use C or C++ for the transitions. And this they do already about 20 years. And you can see that for both, we are actually already starting quite much. Here is the MPS part on actually adding MPS things to ADAS in the all of this technology management stuff, but also a bit towards other disciplines. So to give you some examples from the controller space, there's kind of interface specifications, system capabilities, features that we define, and we take this under the hood of modeling, not just definition, because we basically generate to different IDL kind of formats, but we do more with it. I will show you later some examples that Christina prepared. You can think about integral productivity. So basically, if you have a factory work floor, then you need to take into account all the elements that are there. How far am I away from a refill station to a printer? How long is my entire print chain? How fast are the operators in general? Do they maybe can we maybe find something to give them visual cues with lighting or with colors? How to work faster and how to work more, let's say, robust, pleasant, sustainable. State machines, very obvious. Performance kind of modeling. So on controller level, you can imagine this is important. Then if you say, I want to have a job and it takes me 6 hours, for example, and you cannot predict that it maybe takes 12 hours or more, then you can imagine that someone that has to transport the paper away, the truck driver will have to wait 4 hours. It's not acceptable. So you need to predict it properly, and of course you can also tune on it. And then impositions is basically the thing I told you that, well, you have a PDF file and there is no other input that you get from the client. Okay, there is some basic workflow job stuff that you can do around it, but in general it's a PDF file, and then you need to know exactly what are the impositions, what are the different kinds of things that can happen to the paper, folding, cutting, sometimes one paper becomes two if I cut, and that's basically called impositioning modeling. Now, for the engine modeling, it gets a bit more multidisciplinary. So we have the software and the loop simulation, and this is getting a bit to other disciplines, but it's mainly used in embedded software for testing most of our behavior. Nowadays, we can, I think, about 95% we can test. Instead of on an actual printer, we can just do it virtually in our software-in-the-loop simulation. There's all kinds of physics simulations from other departments. You can think about, for example, stresses, strain computations. You can think about computational fluid dynamics and so on. We have some multidisciplinary models, kind of like system-level models, for example, for the media handling. I will go a bit deeper into that later. We have basically 3D environment modeling, much of it based on the cut information that we have for training operators. Because if you have a machine like this i300, it's, let's say from the window till about here, you cannot just order three of those. They're extremely expensive. So you cannot order them in the training center. And you cannot also, when you start taking it apart as a service engineer, in a virtual environment, there is a button on the wall. I press the button and poof, the whole machine is again completely combined. You can imagine how much work it costs you if you have to do that in real life. There is no magic button. And of course, the model-based control from our mechatronics people, so we have to think more like MATLAB, Simulink-like scenarios. Now, our management doesn't really need to be convinced. So to come back to our abstract, this is a slide that's actually that was presented on the high-tech systems conference by one of our department heads, the mechanics head, where he basically really calls inside and outside that we should work in this kind of way. And we have another slide that's also usually really used by our managers. I did not make these slides, I just copy-pasted them, kind of. And the idea behind here is, of course, the front-loading. So instead of doing a lot of things in the actual lab models, in the actual prototypes, you can go forward for many of the things that you already know by applying a combination of virtual prototyping, of having domain models, and that's where MPS comes in for part, and just proper architecting. Now, I showed you quite some nice examples, but we don't think this is enough. And in general, we think that we kind of need still to go faster, better, and cheaper. And if you look at the kind of effort, how you spread that, then you would want to go from a situation that is like this to, let's say, something that is down here. Eh? So focusing, yeah, well, this is a bit of a more realistic maybe number, but focusing from the how and who does something. And if you do that there, you're basically automating a lot of work. And then disconnect the two. That's where an example could be generators. And of course, once you, you've done the first two steps, you get a lot to the analysis kind of part, where you really, things that Dan told about formal verifications, but also a lot of simulations, you can actually focus on the why and the what you want to build, up to the business people. Yeah, so quite some stories, but we think that we need more. And for us, actually, the next steps in modeling are basically to making it boring, to making it more common. Because we think that you need to apply it for many different people instead of for a few that are, let's say, very productive. I will get a bit deeper into that. And one of the ideas behind, specifically now in the MPS context, is basically one of the things that Marcus presented, that if you make in your own domain all kinds of little tools, you can choose to put them in their own, or all kinds of, let's say, DSLs or domain models. You can choose to put them in separate tools, and then you have quite some effort in the cross-integration. Or you just put one common infrastructure, and then you get basically this language extension, type system, whatever you want, constraints level integration. So the idea is, if you have many times a little bit, that adds up to a lot. So if you can get something that's quite simple or common, and you move it to a lot of people, then the idea is that you get a lot of results. So for example, these kind of things, UML, programming, variables coding, in the software domain, everyone understands this. And then we have people that want to do formal verification, simulation, checking, all these kind of things. And for the many people, that's usually a bit far away. It's not really yet democratized. So how to get there? And this is basically, if you start supporting the current way of working, so going from here and getting it in tools that can actually bring this, can actually connect this, then you start to go in the right direction to the democratization that many times a bit is a lot. And then we've also seen that usually the people that use the models start to become more of developers. Now I'm still talking about partially software business, so that's quite understandable. So for example, once you support a certain way of working, and you can do this with it, all kinds of simulations, tests, and these kind of things, and people will start getting ideas. Oh yeah, but I can get some information from there, or maybe from a different discipline. And then they will say by themselves, I want more. And that brings us to the fact that, or to the statement that I'm going to put here, that if you connect different models, the more you start connecting and you get as much as possible out of the information, that will lead to exponentially added value. Again, with an example, if I have something like state machines and I add something like interfaces to it, I've modeled them, and then I add specifications in terms of requirements and I don't know what kind of high-level specs I need, and a bit of information about the software architecture, and who knows what else, then suddenly I can do a lot of things just by combining this information from many different sources, and just because it becomes possible in a tool like MPS, for example. And for us, that translates basically into what we want and what our management wants. So to give you, I will first give you a few examples from controller and then from embedded. The examples are a little bit, for us, out of date, but they should, or even simplified, but they should give you some idea of what we're doing. So for example, for the state machines in controller, we use the Boost library. And many people used to write that by hand. And it can be really confusing, and sometimes people that are not Boost experts can really make big mistakes with that. So we designed a state machine editor just because it was easy and didn't use the embedder one. No, I'm kidding. Actually, we did this because we wanted to hide all the other concepts and just make it look for people with really, really recognizable things from what they usually do. And basically, these are the slides that Christina used to explain it to people. This was already some while ago, but this was basically, here we're saying we're not using a lot of things. No final states, no extended states, no external transitions, no deep history. Not necessary for now. It needs to be recognizable and understandable for people. And this is basically how we explained without, for now, back then, touching MPS. Just we can have a nice tool which we can produce very fast, which does what you want to do daily with your state machine definitions. Yes? Yes. Boost. For this example, Boost. Yeah, so of course, again, because it was easy, we made a textual editor as well and a tabular editor. And to answer your question then, or to just show it explicitly, there are some generators to make sure that that works. And I remember Christina told me something really nice. There was one of the people, one of the architects in the team that was working here, and he said at some point that the number of lines of code in the tooling are actually smaller than, I think it was, than our smallest component or something like that. And that really played around within the development team. People were like, whoa. Another example is the controller structure. And what happens here is that we extract the code, extract from a combination of code and dependency build files, actually the entire structure of all the components of the controller. So we have a lot of different components with dependencies and interfaces between them. And this tool is not yet meant to do some code generation, but really for analysis. Yeah, so normally you have to make a kind of a feature specification. What do we have to do? Where do we have to cut? Add some things, delete some things, whatever. And that happened in Word. Still oftentimes happens in Word before, and you need quite some time to collect all the information. And there's like this generic tool that we have to search the code base, and then you do some Sherlock Holmes detective work, and then basically you come up to your specification of what to do. And this one here, basically, at least for the interfaces part and the dependencies part, reduces this to just a simple query, where you just make a choice of which interfaces do I want, and then I get the different dependencies. Now maybe it doesn't look very luxurious, but it produces you a very useful kind of insight of what to do. Instead of writing days or a week or whatever on a document, you just get very fast the information. And I think I remember another quote that there was at some point when this was presented, there was a person saying, how can that be that I was told by whatever important guy that this was impossible? And now you suddenly have it. Well, it didn't help to say MPS, but okay. Here you see a bit of how that works. So you basically select a number of interfaces. That you want to see what that will be impacted. The thing queries and basically shows what things are touched. And then from the highest component level, you can go and zoom in. Yeah, so you click in and then you get to kind of the subsystem level, as we call it. And then if you go further, you go to component level, and further you get up to class level. And this thing is actually meant as a kind of hybrid situation to transit from completely code-based to completely model-based, specifying all the things in models, where you basically shouldn't see too much of a difference. Some of the things are in models, and they're fine like this, and code is generated from them, and other things are basically in code, but we see and know the dependencies between them, and can still on the same level kind of query and understand. And let's see, what was this? Oh yeah, so basically, that's the story I just told. So the part of it is reverse engineering, and part of it is forward engineering. And another thing that we added is basically we use within the code base of the controller, we are using these markdown files to document things. So there's this idea of writing embedder documentation, and then you basically get your, you generate your whatever you need documentation for your code base. And for the interface definitions, we have added a dual direction, so you can import them and you can export them. And this is basically also for a transition situation, that people can edit some things, can edit some things and can bring them back again. And that avoids a lot of the discussions of, maybe I'm afraid of the tool or whatever. Yes, Nico? Am I using the same technology for import and export? Is generate, yes. Yes, it's different. Import would be kind of like just a mapping, get the XML, put it in MPS, and export would be a regular MPS generator. And different kinds of representations for different kind of people. The one wants to have it more graphically, the one more textually. No problem with MPS, of course. And there's other work in progress that we're working on, and I'm not going into the work itself, but the vision is actually that the controller structure will be the single point of truth kind of system view for the entire controller with the hybrid contents. So what I said, some of them are actually models and you make code out of them, and other things are code and you make high level models, overview models out of them to see dependencies and to do design. Now, some examples from embedded. So we have something at OSE which is called the Modular OSE Reuse Platform, which is called MORPH. And that's basically kind of like Lego with hardware. You have a base plate or a base board, quite powerful baseboard with all kinds of what we call tiles that you can click on the board. And like this, you can actually quite fast prototype things. And oftentimes, they're cheap enough that if you have these high-end production printers, you can just move them immediately into the product itself. Only when you really scale up a lot, then you need to do something else and make things cheaper. And we have already for years, we have an what I call the electronic software interface. People internally call it the hardware software interface. And there we have defined the concept of kind of IOs, motors, actuators, sensors, and so on, that you can specify on a baseboard and specify how they will actually be living on that baseboard. And we had kind of like different incarnations of that through the years. So some XML version, and then a more fancy XML version, and then the final version. And basically, yeah, this is not the interesting part. You need some kind of base information to be able to generate all kinds of artifacts. But the MPS version enables people to actually have this kind of fill-in form where they just start editing things and all the names automatically update and so on. Of course, we know that projectional editing is simple, but it, the first time people saw that, it blew their mind, really. Oh, that saves me so much work. And basically what we use that for, oh yeah, I forgot to show you the projections, but you can imagine that we are using this for three types of stakeholders. One would be the electronics people who want to see their own information, like what kind of slots, what kind of things I want to use for my hardware board. And the other one would be for the software people, well, but I have a software module and I want to know to which module that belongs, and so on. And then the third one would be the service people that just need to know, okay, I have this name, and if I go to my service tool and I can do something with it, then I need to know what is my technical documentation. So that's basically the kind of artifacts that we connect to. So the hardware people usually get some VHDL code out of that, with which they configure their hardware platform. The software people get their APIs that are necessary to steer the hardware, and the service people get a part of the technical service manual. Now let me tell you a little bit about, or show you a bit about the transporting the sheets through an i300 printer. So this is a marketing video from the i300. And basically, if you zoom in, you see, you can see here that can actually not work. That's why it's a marketing video. Two sheets cannot move over each other like this, but okay. But you can see here that here is a smaller gap than here. You can play with these gaps, and you can do something that is called scheduling on top of paper, which means I have here a buffer, and I can put more papers here and less there. And in this combination, you can basically play with productivity, and you can get a certain maximum productivity out of a certain type of design of a paper path. So the way the papers can move is called a paper path or a layout. And basically, we can abstract that away to a system level. And you can imagine there are some paper guides, and if you want to move through them, then you can see the paper cannot move out between the paper guides. And what you get is a kind of a line, nominally, how the paper starts moving. And you can add something to that like coordinates, which we call points of interest. And on these coordinates, you can map all kinds of elements. You can have, for example, a thing that we call a pinch or a nip. Those are two rolls that move the paper. Transport elements. You can have a sensor that knows, okay, the paper is here now. Or you can have a switch that says, well, the paper has to go in this or in that direction. And of course, you can connect all kinds of things like motors. You can have a motor to a pinch so that it really turns. Or you can have a solenoid magnet for the switch so that it really switches, clicks. And basically, and now I'm going to do some comical thing. So it was really in the very much past. This is how it happened. And we improved that a lot in the 90s. By making a specific model. But still, there was not a clear connection. So then we added in the mechanics people and imported the models from there. And basically, effectively, it was usable as an API, the layout. Where is the sheet? Where do I need to be? But then, we got a lot of files and the guy who needs to know about a lot of different files. So what we did is we paired a language engineer with this guy, and then made sure that this layout can be reused in all kinds of different places for a simulation, for the control, and for analysis purposes. Here you can see an example of the analysis. For example, for our software in the loop simulation, it's all the time the same kind of layout coming back, with the same kind of positions, same information, and for the embedded software itself. And to give you some example, here we use the Itamus graphical editor, in fact, to specify our paper path. And this is very useful for a person who has to work on the timing, because the CAD people need a certain time to baseline a layout. And until they baseline, maybe I want to play around with a certain, what if I move this to there and it becomes shorter and suddenly I have a better productive layout. I can immediately tell this to the CAD people and they will know. And of course, with all the necessary MPS stuff that goes with it. Then we have a textual DSL basically on top of that layout, where you can specify routes. So I'm coming from here, and I'm going out to the output module via all kinds of different points. That's what you basically see here. One route is cut into sectors. And then once you go through the sectors, you connect to the actual points. Here, 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 here. And that's how you get quite fast an insight of how dynamically the thing moves. So it's not only about static stuff anymore. You can add jobs. You can add all kinds of timing specifications on top of that. Because my time is running out, I'm not going too much into that. 1 minute, I'm sorry. You can put actions on top of that. And we also use mathematical notations in the basic code. So basically, our people that make the base code, like calculating routes and so on, they really want to use these notations. So from Embedder and Embedder platform. So effectively, what we've done is for all these things, we have given a front end on the MPS side. There is some stuff about variant management and so on, but I'm not going too much into that. Basically, what you see here is that you can take a number of modules, and once you know the variant, you can combine it. One variant looks like this, and the bigger variant looks like this. The paper path is suddenly longer. The vision here is, in fact, that we make interfaces with other disciplines, so that on system level, we have a consistent and well-understood architecture and implementation. And basically, we combine all of that in what we call a landscape of opportunities. for model-based development. And we use this picture basically to make roadmaps and all kinds of common understandings to move in the right direction together. And maybe if there is still a bit of time, it's finished. Okay, a little bit. Well, then we just go to maybe the important part that's good for this conference. So we are really happy with the JetBrains MPS team and with Itemis. We have very good communication with them. There are a few things that can be a little bit better, like, but we've heard that today. We want web-based. We want too deep kind of positioning in the editors. For example, for the debuggers, instead of having line-based, we want to have, if I have two graphical things on one line, I want to know where is my breakpoint, for example. But overall, I would say it's a very good experience, and I can recommend definitely the courses from JetBrains, because they give a gentle introduction for the basics, and then all the advanced stuff you can get from the Itemis, things like variant management, IATS3, and so on. All over, it's an exciting journey, I would say. I don't think there's room for questions, so you can always...